So we're here for the Supervisorial Candidate Forum on Child Health and Nutrition. It's been so graciously hosted by the Gopher Health and United Way of Santa Cruz County. So we're going to be asking these candidates a series of questions. They have a minute to answer. After I get to the fifth question today, and I'll remind you, we're going to be taking questions from the audience. So I believe there's some cards that are going to be passed out sometime throughout this morning. Please write legibly. I have a hard time reading my own writing. So if you don't write well, please print. Don't write in cursive. I'm not going to try to guess. I will not ask your question if I can't read it. All right, so question one for you guys. Since 2001, California has had Labor Code 1030-1033 that requires employers to provide space and time for mothers to express breast milk at work. Few employers know about that law, and if elected, how would you support employers to know and promote the law? Remember, 1 minute. Eric, I'll just start.
That's not Eric.
Rich. Rich McInnes, sorry.
As far as this law, I have a small business, and I would definitely understand the concerns and issues involved around this issue. As far as getting the word out, I would start some sort of an online direct mail and some sort of a television campaign to educate the other business owners in my district so that they can be aware of this program and make it easier for women who are pregnant and breastfeeding to have the capability to do this at work. Thank you.
My bad, I'm a little nervous, not usually, but I'm gonna go ahead and introduce each one of these guys real quick so that everybody knows who we're talking to.
I'm Rich McInnes, 2nd District, thank you.
Zach Friend, 2nd District.
John Leopold, County Supervisor from the 1st District.
Gary Richard Arnold, 1st District, Man Against the Machine.
Bruce McPherson, candidate for the 5th District Supervisor.
Eric Hammer, candidate for the 5th District Supervisor.
Perfect, guys. Thanks. So, Zach, if you want to go ahead and take that question for us, please.
Thank you, Danny. Well, I see that you could do three things here. I think the first thing is that the county itself should actually create, in essence, a model lactation support program for its own employees as sort of the lead. And I think number two, both the federal programs that are associated with this that provide resource kits to add both advocates and to businesses, we could probably leverage the support of both Dominican and Sutter at the county level and some of the experts that are associated with those institutions for county-wide businesses. And I think the third thing would be, I was actually thinking about this last night, I was thinking that the same way that the county does green business certification, which is really just an awareness program, we could do a similar thing for businesses that do lactation support programs for its employees, which is an awareness or a recognition program, some sort of certification program that the county takes the lead on that helps increase awareness.
Thank you, Zach.
Well, good morning, and first I want to thank you for inviting us to participate in today's forum. With the passage of this bill, the county set about to create a lactation policy, which now means that it's clear that women are allowed to take the break when they need to express breast milk. And we've also created a place where they can do it safely and privately that's not a restroom. I think that's an important part of what needs to happen, but we're also part of a larger breastfeeding collaborative, and we're working with our public health staff to educate the community about this. And we may need to do more. As I look at one of my commissioners on the Women's Commission, this may be a great idea for our Women's Commission to help in sort of the public advocacy and education about this. I look forward to working with the community on it.
Gary Richard Arnold. I think we've got scores of nonprofits in the area, many of whom feature emphasis on women. And I think in the same places where they post the wages and all the other information for employers. It would be nice to have probably some printers print up something that's fairly attractive, reminding them that this is now law. And I think with the organizations making visits like this, it would be coming as a friendly reminder for them. They'd be much more encouraged to adopt or easily adopt it. And it could be reiterated or followed up every 18 or every 2 years or so, just to make sure that it stays on top of their agenda.
Thank you. I want to thank United Way for having this and the other agencies as well. United Way, which I've been a member of the board of directors or a donor to for all my life. And I think this is a matter of the county setting an example. We should be ones that are out front in this and make it be very visible to the public that this is what we're promoting in the county. But secondly, I think it's a matter of communication with the private sector. I think that we need to coordinate our activities with the local business councils, the chambers of commerce, and those who own and operate those businesses to explain the law, because I just don't think it's well known enough. And I think it's a matter of communication that we lead the way to let people know what is required of them. And I think that we should lead by example in the county.
I think it's about, again, communication and education. I'm a small business owner, and when laws change, Cal OSHA or regulatory laws change, I have letters in my mailbox. I'm bombarded with them. So it's like, you know, how can you miss it? I think that we need to partner with other outside agencies like that so that mailers can go out and information can be provided to business owners. But then again, I think we need an educational component of it to outreach to that business community to show them ways and teach them ways in which their business can provide a safe place and provide the program that women need. On top of that, I'm president of the Business Association, and I think outreaching and coming and giving a talk in front of my business association to all the small businesses that are part of it would be fantastic. I know that that's never happened. And then when you take and throw in all the chambers, you're going to outreach to a lot of small businesses that way. Thank you.
All right. Well, congratulations. You made it through your first question. I'm going to go ahead and mention the co-sponsors at this time. Sponsored by WIC, First Five, Gopher Health, Child Care Planning Council, Second Harvest Food Bank, and the Central Coast School Food Alliance. Go ahead and jump up. I would, while we have Mr. Rivas taking the stage, I would just have to say some of the ideas that I would imagine imploring would be definitely getting in front of chamber. That's a good place. A lot of businesses, you know, go to that, and it's a good opportunity to discuss those kind of things. Welcome to the panel.
Yeah, it's a bit accent over there, so.
No problem. So do we want to give him a chance to answer question number one, since he hasn't had a chance to do that? Okay, so I'll reread that for you, Mr. Rivas.
Mm-hmm.
Since 2001, California has had Labor Code 1030-1033 that requires employers to provide space and time for mothers to express breast milk at work. Few employers know about the law, and if elected, how would you support employers to know and promote the law? You have 1 minute.
One of the things that that we have done in the city of Watsonville is that be able to provide some provide more information in regards to the law, to the business community. One of the things that we did in Watsonville, we did a march, be able to promote that kind of, so provide the information and resources that we have within our city. So as a county supervisor, we'll do the same thing, provide that information. So to the business, to the school community, as well as the areas that we that need to be done. That's something that we need to do more as a county, to provide more resources and information throughout the community. It's something that we'll do very closely in the city of Watsonville, and I continue to do that, to ensure that we continue to do that.
Thank you very much. Okay, we'll be moving on to question number two. Santa Cruz County has a documented shortage of quality and affordable child care options, and proposed state budget cuts further place some current programs in jeopardy of closing, leaving working families with less safe and affordable care options. How would you help support quality child care programs for working families? And we'll just start with Rich, please. Mr. McInnes.
As a previous latchkey kid myself, I'm well aware of the a lack of childcare options. And I would do whatever it takes not to cut any current or government funding that's currently in place for childcare options. And I would explore alternative options and try to fund those options as well so that we can have more options out there for single mothers and fathers out there raising a family. Thank you.
I think, you know, as a county, we have to be more proactive in providing quality child care. What I mean, you know, quality care is that we be able to provide licensed child care centers. Like, you know, we have a beautiful example like the Head Start programs and the migrant Head Start programs that provide a lot of quality health, you know, child care. One of the things that it's important that we try to, like, you know, the program that we have, it's very important because we provide the stimulation and socialization of children outside the home. That is very important because they will be ready for school. That's something that we as an educator, we can be able to do that. I think it's important that we continue to provide, along with that, the nutritional meals, educational learning, and hopefully bilingual education with the child care. Another concern I have is the teen pregnancy that we have is a big concern within our Latino community. We need to provide more help that we have in Watsonville High School, Cabrillo College, so we can provide working mothers to provide, you know, child care so they can be able to provide, you know, get the jobs, give education. At the same time, we can be able to provide that child care. It's very important for me to see, to continue that. Thank you.
Mr. Friend, please.
Well, actually, this issue has occurred in my own family. Both my sisters-in-law were faced with what I really see as a false choice. After they had had their children, they had to make a decision because of the high cost of childcare, whether they would be able to rejoin the labor force, and they actually were unable to, which is an unfortunate thing that they were even forced with this choice. And as I thought about it, I realized that I think that the discussion of childcare needs to leave sort of the subsidy discussion and more become one as a part of economic development. I mean, the reality is that people are being forced to make legitimate economic decisions. And if you elevate it to an economic development discussion as opposed to, is this just part of a community program or just part of a social service? And unfortunately, those tend to be treated at a different scale than those in economic development. Then I think that the entire discussion can actually change. And I think if we start looking at early education programs and what economic return that has and child care options and early health care options and what returns we actually get on that, it'll totally change the discussion and change the context by which we are even having this debate. Thanks.
Santa Cruz County is the third most expensive region in the country to live in. So it is imperative that we have a quality child care system here in Santa Cruz County, and it's imperative that local government support our child care system. I participated in the county's task force on community programs, which is a significant amount of research, which really showed significant gaps in our county where quality child care was not available. I believe that we need to work to close those gaps. I was disappointed that the board chose not to continue on with that community program process, and I look to restart that with a new board. I also think that we need to work with other partners, such as the First Five Commission, to help provide funding, and we need to make sure that, as I've done for the past 3 years on the Board of Supervisors, to fight for funding for our community programs and not let it slide any further than it already has. We need to support programs that support families.
Gary Richard Arnold. I think in addition to being just an economic decision, it's a human decision. And we've seen what's happened in many of the inner cities where the man was driven from the family. I think we need to use our neighbors, our relatives, and our friends. We have an emergency care training over here by the Dominican Hospital. They have a babysitter program that qualifies young girls to watch over your children. I think this would be the way to go. Turning the children more and more over to the state is disrupting for their future. And in this way, you've got your friends, your neighbors, and the child is at home. And I would encourage that as a remedy.
Yeah, with the state budget cuts that we have and ones that fall down also on the county, we need to do the best we can with our own limited resources. And as a matter of fact, this county, I think, is doing a very good job with what it does have. We are fortunate to have a wide range of nonprofit agencies who address these issues. And we're fortunate to have the Human Care Alliance of 50-some agencies who coordinate activities as best they can for an efficient and effective process. We have to rely more on them. As I suggested in a previous forum, give them a floor to say we can't go any lower than this. And this is going to be something that you have to discuss in budget discussions. The fact of the matter is, with the economy that we have in our world today, two-worker families, it's a common thing. And there's more need for childcare than ever. And we ought to see what we can do, the best way we can do to provide that.
Excellent. Being a father of 6.5-year-old twins and having a 14-year-old teenager, childcare is a huge issue for us. So I've seen it, you know, right up front, and what families go through, especially when we had young babies and, you know, an 8-year-old going to school. I think that Santa Cruz actually isn't just doing a good job. They've set the bar in the state. We have an organization called Child Care Planning Council, the Child Care Planning Council, that has done a strategic plan. They have seen some of the shortfalls that are going to be coming, and they have a plan to work with this community to do the outsource and the programming that's necessary. What is unfortunate is 97% of the kids that are eligible through the census that show need child care, need support, are not getting, those needs aren't getting met. We really need to work harder in this community to help that 97% and get them the education that they need. Thank you.
All right, so we're going to mix things up a little bit. We're going to start jumping around with the candidates now that you guys are all comfortable. Just in case you've just walked in, my name is Danny Keith. I'm the moderator for this panel discussion today. It's the Supervisorial Candidate Forum on Child Health and Nutrition, hosted by Gopher Health and United Way of Santa Cruz County, co-sponsored by WIC, First Five, Gopher Health, Child Care Planning Council, Second Harvest Food Bank, and Central Coast School Food Alliance. So my next question, I'm going to be starting with Mr. Arnold, and I'll be selecting people randomly, so be prepared and on your toes. Question number 3. Despite significant outreach efforts, our county is ranked 45th out of 58 counties in California in terms of CalFresh participation by income-eligible persons. What will you do as a supervisor to boost countywide participation in CalFresh, which is formerly food stamps?
Well, I encourage those who are investigating this, learn from those who are not collecting the food stamps and try to trim the program back. I don't think welfare is beneficial in the long run. It's merely a transfusion from your neighbors into a welfare program. The biggest welfare program we've got going is Social Security, which is neither social nor secure. Those monies go directly to the Federal Reserve banks. They don't even go into the general spending fund that the Congress uses. And they've spent every cent of that has disappeared. They've never put it aside for you any way, shape, or form. So I think welfare is a trap. I think there should be a underlying safety net, and it should be used for those people only.
All right, Mr. Hammer, would you please take this question?
Sure. I think, as I've stated before, it's about information and education. It's getting the word out to the communities and to the people that there is assistance available. With my experience working with Mountain Community Resource Center, which is a family resource center that has drop-in facilities that house several of the nonprofits that we've been discussing, you know, it's having outreach in those areas. You know, we've got 7 family resource centers out there that are helping to spread the word that there is support available. But I think you need to go a lot further than that. I think you need to partner with businesses. I think you need to partner with schools. You need to partner with state agencies to give out education. And on top of that, you need to take away the stigma about welfare and aid, that it's okay to get help. It's okay to buy food, nutritious food, for your families without public ridicule around it. Thank you.
All right. Thank you very much. Mr. Friend, would you mind taking this question, please?
Well, anytime you're in the bottom quartile of something, I think it's time to look at some of the barriers to access to the information in the program. And I think that one of the things, it's a pretty cumbersome process to actually apply for anybody who's been through it, as members of my family actually have. And I think that one of the things that we can do is permit technology to more quickly and efficiently allow you to understand whether you qualify for the benefits, as well as allow for the communication between county HHS to the applicant, which is currently something you cannot do electronically. I agree with Mr. Hammer as well that there just is a historic stigma associated with it that's an unfortunate cultural thing that I think needs to stop. But I believe just as far as barriers to access, the technological improvements in and of itself I think would significantly improve and streamline the application process for people and communications process. Thanks.
Great. Mr. McPherson, please.
I have to agree with, don't have to, I do agree with the, that we need better communication on how to have a, how a family can qualify for CalFresh. I think part of the answer could be that some of the private agencies, or that the nonprofit agencies, I should say, excuse me, are doing such a great job of providing food for our county residents. I don't know exactly how that plays into it, but Second Harvest Food Bank, Gray Bears, they collect and distribute thousands of pounds of food. And about 20 years ago, we had three people in agriculture, Jess Brown, Willie McCree, and Tim Driscoll, that said they would coordinate an Ag Against Hunger program here. In that time, they have delivered 200 million pounds of food to our county residents. They're to be applauded for that. We need to encourage more people to do it, but we have an agricultural community that is very aware of it, and we should be appreciative of what they do for us.
Thank you very much. Mr. Leopold, please.
Thank you. It is completely unacceptable that we fall 45th on the list of 58. In our county, one in four people are on some form of public assistance. We need to do a better job of making sure that they have access to all the resources that are out there. We need to make sure that we can simplify registration. We need to do effective outreach. We need to increase our collaboration with our community-based organizations who are working with people in need. We've got to make sure that that people have access to information and it's easy to apply. We have to take advantage of every time people interact with either county government or local community-based organizations in order to ensure that they have access to resources that are available and to help them and their family. Our Health Services Agency and our Human Services Department are working together to do outreach and nutrition, but we all have a responsibility of ourselves and as county government as a whole to make sure that we're reaching out to people, especially those who are in need and vulnerable, to make sure that they have access to healthy food.
Mr. Rivas, please.
It's very disappointing that the county hasn't done enough, like Leopold said, as that the emphasis has been done in different areas. One of the things that we need to do is, like, you know, Mr. Leopold, is to do more outreach. One of the things that, you know, as an educator, you know, at the high school level and elementary level, you know, we're able to do, you know, working with the schools as they apply for free lunches, you know, we can be able to understand and comprehend, you know, who they are. It is important that we work with the schools, with the business community as well, and the nonprofits to be able to do. One of the things that we really do in the city of Watsonville, we go to the farmers market, so as they go along with it and provide, you know, that access to be with the community and asking questions, and sometimes they can be able to get the food stamp. You can be able to trade your food stamps there to buy nutritional meals in the farmers market. I think it's important to continue to do outreach work in the community. As the county government, we have to go in there, and also to do more bilingual information for our Latino community. It's very important to do that because I think our Latino community are very proud to ask for food stamps sometimes, and I think, you know, we need to, and they need it. Our seniors also, they need to be provided to get more information that it's important that we provide that outreach as much as we can. Thank you.
Mr. McGinnis, please.
Yes, if I'm elected, I would promote a county outreach program in order to educate and reach the families who qualify but not are but currently are not participating in the program. This would be, this program would consist of a community TV, radio, and direct mail advertising to get to these folks. And I think the main goal of the program would be to try to reduce the stigma of accepting help from your county government in terms of CalFresh or food stamps, what it used to be called, because I think that's probably the big issue to overcome. Thank you.
All right. I just want to remind everybody that we are currently recording this for TV. Community television will be broadcasting this at a later date. You need to check communitytv.org. That's Peter McEdigan over there filming. And I'll be honest, that question was a hard one for me not to want to jump up and answer, being in the social service game. It definitely is a stigma situation, and I appreciate everybody's input and willingness to continue to work on this problem we have in the county. I'm going to go to question number four now. Still going to pull the round robin, so be on your toes. As a supervisor, and this is a hard question, how will you assist local schools in preparing and providing more nutritious meals to students, and how would you engage local farmers in the effort to improve school meals? I'm going to go ahead and start with Mr. Friend on this one.
Well, I was fortunate to attend recently an event that the Secretary of Agriculture put on in Salinas regarding exactly this. I mean, we really need to expand the farm to school program, because farmers need to understand what's going on in local schools, and schools need to, from a childhood nutrition standpoint, schools need to understand what's actually happening to the family farmer. I think if you grow these two links, you can have some pretty remarkable benefits. If you think about it, kids will have access to more nutritious food. It'll also be less expensive and connected in with their local environment. Schools will also be able to benefit their local farms. As many of you know, there's significant threats to county and regional farmland, and this is something that I think that if you can develop that symbiotic relationship, that can be pretty important. I think this is something actually at the national level they're starting to take a lead on, so I don't see any reason why at the county level we couldn't do the exact same thing.
Thank you, and I just want to remind everyone that these questions were provided by our co-sponsors. Our co-sponsors today were our WIC, First Five, Gopher Health, Child Care Planning Council, Second Harvest Food Bank, and the Central Coast School Food Alliance. I'm going to go ahead and turn to Mr. McPherson for this question, please.
Yeah, we have to coordinate our efforts with the school districts that are independent governing agencies, as we know. We also need to start at home with every one of us here. We need to educate the parents of the value of a nutritional meal for their children, and really warn them of the terrible consequences that we face. Last night I was asked, what is the biggest problem facing our youth or children? And I said obesity, because this used to be rare. Diabetes type 2 used to be a rare occurrence. Now it is getting 1 in 3 in the nation, and it's more than that in this county. This can lead to very serious consequences on the health services that we provide in the future, but more important to that, to the health care for our children. We need to educate ourselves. We need to expand our education efforts to the school districts. And I am confident, as the agriculture community has done in the past, they will coordinate their efforts and get into this game and help us face this problem.
Mr. Rivas.
Yes, I'm just really very proud to it, as mayor, be able to do the Jóvenes Sanos. We set up a subcommittee with our city of Watsonville, and city of Watsonville to be able to attack the obesity within our city. Jóvenes Sanos is a youth program that I able to, for local Watsonville High School, Pajaro Valley, different areas, in which we able to combat that. We set up the subcommittee, and then we pass that ordinance, in the sense, so work with the with the business community, so we'll be able to provide nutritional meals, nutritional food products within our city. This is where I would like to continue to work with the youth, so we can be able to fight this obesity within ourselves. And also, it's very important that we won a national award for Jóvenes Sanos, for the things that we have done in the city of Watsonville. I will continue to do that as a county supervisor. The other thing is that as part of the Pajaro Valley Health Trust, we able to do also to provide, funding for nutritionists, so to fight obesity, diabetes, heart disease, which is an epidemic within the county. And the last one is, we're very part of it to be able to get that grant, Go Health grant, in which I wrote the letter, in which I able to get that grant within our county. It's very, very proud to have that grant for the whole county. And thank you for that.
Thank you, Mr. Rivas. Just remind the panelists to please try to stick to the minute. Go ahead, Mr. Hammer, please take that question.
All right, I'm going to address that a little more locally. Boulder Creek Elementary, where my kids attend, you know, there was a group of parents up there in the last year, 2 years, that were working with the school district to provide better lunches. And they took it upon themselves to create a group to partner with some local organic growers to bring in and work with a cook and started making a meal a week, I believe it was, of fresh vegetables and fresh foods. And it was perceived really well with the students and with parents. I think you're going to need to see more action like that, because you need to also educate at home. You know, we just went to the dentist this week, and the dentist said, hey, you need to cut back the amount of milk that you're serving your kids because of the high content of sugar. It's amazing where we find sugar, and we have to be able to talk to parents and talk to school and change our entire concept around nutrition. Huge changes need to take effect. Thank you.
Mr. Leopold.
Thank you. I think there's really three parts to this. One is the county health services needs to work with our food services director at our local schools to make sure that they promoting healthy foods and also pilots some project like in-class breakfast or other creative ways in order to get healthy foods to people. I believe that you know, if you had universal school lunch where you didn't have to qualify for it and there wasn't a stigma to who gets free lunch or not, it would be a go a long way. I think we also need to support actions like the Central Coast School Food Alliance, which came together a couple years back to look at this very issue and to work with local farmers, nonprofit organizations, school districts to figure out how we get good, healthy food to our kids. Lastly, we need to think about the investments we make as county government and make sure that we're investing in those things that support healthy eating. And I'll just give you two examples. One is the county recently was able to apply for CDBG funding, and we applied for the Passion for Produce program. And second is we're investing in a new Boys and Girls Club in Live Oak, which will have a demonstration kitchen. And I've already reached out to Jamie Smith from the Santa Cruz City Schools, who's also a Live Oak resident, to think about how we can do programming to be able to support children and families.
Thank you. Mr. McInnes, please.
Yeah, I remember when I was in elementary school and I was in a government program that provided free lunches to low-income families. And I've never forgotten Hot Dog Mondays and Taco Tuesdays that we had at the school. I think it's important that all of our kids get three square meals a day, whether they get it at home or at school or somewhere by our government, because that helps them to concentrate and learn. And that's one of the main bases of a healthy kid. But I do think those meals need to be a lot better and a lot fresher than the meals I was served as a kid. So I would definitely reach out to our local farmers and try and provide them with access to get their foods into our schools, so that we could basically, like Zach said, use our local produce in our local schools. And I think it would be a nice little circle to have both of those industries come together and provide great lunches for our kids. Thank you.
Thank you. Mr. Arnold, please.
Yeah, good Lord. We've got three meals a day. We got school itself. We got after school. We got babysitting. We might as well get the bunks, raise the North Korean flag, let the people abandon their children to the Board of Supervisors. Let us sit here as a Soviet and take care of your children for you. This is outrageous. I'd rather see a kid home, hungry, and free than what these people are advocating, because they have to dictate all of this stuff to the parents. They have to steal from their neighbors in order to do this. There is no state money. There is no federal money. The money comes from you. Government has no money. The only money they have is what they take from the people themselves. And if they want to provide every solitary need, you're going to be like Gulliver, tied up with all of these various rules. It's outrageous. It's an attack against freedom. Many of these mandates are coming through an outfit. They have a contract with the World Bank called ICLEI. You need to know about that. ICLEI sets the protocols for the policy decisions by the Board of Supervisors.
Okay. All right, I just want to remind everybody that we're here for the Supervisorial Candidate Forum on Child Health and Nutrition, hosted by Gopher Health, United Way of Santa Cruz County, co-sponsored by WIC, First Five, Gopher Health, Child Care Planning Council, Second Harvest Food Bank, and Central Coast School Food Alliance. Now we're on our last question for the day. I would implore people to please fill out a card if you'd like to have me ask a question. We're going to be selecting a couple questions for the panelists to answer, and we'll be moving into that fifth question. Just a little footnote on the old School Food Alliance program that's going on. Currently, Second Harvest Food Bank has been working with these guys to distribute thousands of pounds of fresh fruit and produce to the schools at no cost. So there's no taxpayer dollars that are going towards that. I'm gonna go ahead and ask the fifth question. If elected as supervisor, you will be a commissioner on the Regional Transportation Commission. What will you do in that role to support and promote safe routes to schools and parks and regular use of active transportation in our county? I'm going to go ahead and start with Mr. Leopold on this one.
Thank you. In 2009, I led a community planning effort around our redevelopment funds that brought out 500 people. And one of the five goals they were interested in was safe routes for walking and biking. We made investments with our final redevelopment dollars to support safe access from Soquel High down to Soquel Village, from the Yacht Harbor over to 7th Avenue on East Cliff Drive, and we need to continue to do that work. I think it's also critically important that we complete the purchase of the rail line and create the rail trail that many county residents are interested in. About three-quarters of our population lives within a half mile of the railroad tracks. There are 12 schools on that rail line. If we can get a good rail trail going, that becomes a place where kids can bike and walk to get to school and to get home safely and in an active way, rather than having to depend on some other form of transportation.
Thank you. Mr. Hammer.
I look forward to sitting on the RTC, and when you take a look at what's needed as far as bike lanes and bike paths and walking paths and outside recreation. I've been working locally on those issues now. I'm working with People Power to put a safe route to school up at San Lorenzo Valley. We've had two working meetings, and we are doing outreach and starting to involve more of the community. I helped with Boulder Creek Parks and Rec build a new playground facility and park in Boulder Creek. We did a $375,000 renovation. And when we drive by there every day now, you're seeing after school programs meeting at that park and playing on the equipment, running around the track. You see youth soccer, and I'm talking under five youth soccer, for young kids. It's getting them involved and motivated in sports programming at a young age. So those are just two examples of what I'm currently working on. Thank you.
Mr. Arnold.
Yes, the community is really rich in senior citizens and activists such as yourselves, and we've got plenty of computer techs. I think a coordination for zoning guards and people at the various parks and so forth could be accomplished, and I think that's one way to address safety at the parks and the walkways.
Mr. McInnes.
Yeah, I will continue to support existing transportation options available today, and I would also look to add other options as well, such as the rail trail and adding more bike lanes, as well as widening Highway 1, because I was stuck on Highway 1 on my way here today from Aptos. And all those other options would leave people with several different ways that they could get down to my business down at the Seabreeze Tavern in Aptos. So I'm big for transportation, and I want to thank you guys for all the opportunity to speak today. Thanks.
Mr. McPherson.
Yeah, I've had discussions with the Safe Routes to Schools program as well, and that is something that we need to really look forward to in the future. We need to promote all alternate forms of transportation, from bikes for age-appropriate children to walking more to school, and to better utilize our bus system. Years ago, many of our children went to school on a bus. Today, we have many more children, but we have fewer bus routes. I think the immediate concern there is that we have probably over 1,500 to 1,700 school children going to the San Lorenzo Valley campus, and most of them are driving themselves or being driven, and there's a parking lot two times a day on Highway 9. I think that we need to work with our public transit system, which is underutilized, and until it increases ridership, it's highly unlikely that the number of routes will be increased. I do think that we can have a win-win situation here and have more people take public transit, including our students, to school.
Thank you. Mr. Rivas.
Yes, as a former transportation commissioner with Santa Cruz County, one of the things that we have done in our city of Watsonville, Pajaro Unified School District was one of the things that was part of our plan, because the mayor of the city of Watsonville, we were able to locate that Pajaro Unified School to be a walking community. You can say 70% of our students walk to school, and also Rolling Hills Middle School, same way, the walk to school. You can be able to, that's the intent of part of the livable communities plan that that we adopted as the city council and the city of Watsonville, to have more walking communities. Safe schools, same way, Pajaro Unified School District is a great way of working with the government and as well as our schools and our district. It's important that we continue to provide that kind of service. The service that we provide for bus routes, we need to do more of that. As a county supervisor, I continue to continue to do the livable communities plan for the county, because it's a great plan that we have adopted in our city of Watsonville and needs to be adopted at the county level.
Thank you, Mr. Rivas. Mr. Friend, please.
Well, this is one of the most common questions, if not the most common question I get asked. There aren't safe routes to school in my district. In fact, there aren't safe routes for candidates to precinct walk in my district either. And I think that, in part, a lot of this has to do with, I agree with Supervisor Leopold about bringing together the right people. And the second component is sort of ending the either-or mentality that's been focused on so much so at the transportation funding level at the county, which is that we've kind of created a lot of false choices of, you can either do highway improvements or you can fix the local roads, you can either fund the metro or you can build sidewalks. And I think realistically we need to look at a holistic approach to these things, because it just simply is not a safe-based route right now for kids, and we need to end that discussion of either or in that way. And I think if we do that with a priority standpoint, we can make a significant difference.
All right, we've come to the conclusion of the prepared questions. I'm going to move into the community questions. I just want to thank the candidates for their time. I'm going to go ahead and move into the first question from the audience. This is I'm not sure if this is a statement. You guys will go ahead and address it. I'll do the round robin nonetheless. So like I said, this is more of a statement than a question. Youth voice and empowerment. Health does not start in the hospital, but in the community. The California Endowment, what will you do, what will you do or have done in your district and countywide towards the end of, this is really hard to read. I told you not to write in cursive. Did I tell people not to write in cursive? There are 600 existing faith-based and nonprofits here in Santa Cruz County. What is wanted and needed from your insights and strategies to involve youth? And how do you plan on solving this for healthy communities? Does that make sense to you guys? Okay. Whose question was it? Okay, maybe you could clarify. Question as I best can. Basically, what I believe he's asking is, how are we going to empower the youth to be part of this solution? So I'm going to go ahead and start with Mr. Rivas on this one.
Yeah, one thing that we have done is for us, you know, we almost 30% of our city of Watsonville are youth. One of the things that we have done is, you know, I have brought, you know, as the mayor of Watsonville, we have brought the city council members to have a city council meeting at the high school. And something that, you know, we need to do that to bring the government to the youth because so they can be able to participate. It was great to the questions of our youth participation. And what happened with that is that now our youth comes to the council. It's a government and economics teacher. One of the requirements is to go to the city council members so they can get involved and understand and comprehend what's going on with city government. And also we have involved a lot of the youth to provide ideas, ordinance. Like one of the things that the ordinance that they've provided to us and we implemented is the no smoking ban in parks. And as well, that's very important for us. And they brought to us that ordinance and we passed it, and now we have no smoking at the parks. That's the involvement that we like to do, and we have to do it at the county level too, to bring those, you know, to bring the county government to the schools so they can understand and comprehend what the county government does and do for our community.
Thank you, Mr. Rivas. Mr. Arnold, please.
Yeah, I don't think the you should be mandated with having to volunteer and be involved. I think they need to create their own traction by studying hard, understanding their own power, and creating their own life. I think the government should get the hell out of their way and stop trying to control and make them behave in a way that the government thinks they should behave. We're abusing our children by trying to shape them in every way, shape, and form.
All right, Mr. Friend, please.
I was recently speaking to a group of high school students, and I asked them a simple question. Why is it that you don't vote? These were seniors at Santa Cruz High, and they said, well, because none of the elected officials speak about any of our issues. And I said, none of the elected officials speak about your issues because you don't vote. It occurred to me that there is a real feeling with youth, and it's fair. And looking up here, it's sort of reflected that there isn't really necessarily an interest in youth in politics. You know, that you really speak down to people as opposed to include people within the process. I mean, I've worked for the last decade in local law enforcement. I've seen what the unfortunate end results of failures in a lot of programs can be. And I've seen the need to, we're talking very early intervention. 10, 11, 12-year-olds are getting involved in some very serious things. And until we recognize that they are a part of the process and we don't speak down to them and decide that our policy is their policy, but their policy should be our policy, we're going to continue to have this as a cyclical problem. Thank you.
Mr. McInnes, please.
Yeah, I would reach out to both Cabrillo and the UCSC system, as well as both our middle and high schools, to educate our youth and get them involved in our community on all levels, because I think the earlier that you get the kids participating in our local government, as well as all the programs available in our county, the better you have a chance to get them involved. Even when it goes back to nonprofit and volunteering, et cetera, I think if it's something kids are doing at a younger age, it'll impact them as they move on through life and grow older. Thank you.
Mr. Hammer.
I think youth empowerment is extremely important, and there's a certain section of the youth that really enjoy it. You can't force everybody into it, but through peer pressure, positive peer pressure, people get involved. When we had Youth First, we had a youth advisory board that helped steer our programs, and we gave the kids the input that they gave us the input that was needed on what they wanted in their community. If you take a look at the skate park that was built at Highlands, the youth were very much involved in the design concept and making that happen. If you take a look at San Lorenzo Valley High School, they have a diversity club that is phenomenal. It speaks to so many different issues out that teens and kids are going through every day, and they're young leaders. You know, I went to two of their events, and the energy in that room, they reach out and they are looked upon as huge role models within their school, and they're getting statewide recognition for that. So you start empowering a few and that will spread.
Mr. Leopold.
Thank you. I think the job of any elected official is to reach out to his constituency and engage them in local government. As a county supervisor, when we've done community planning, I reached out and worked with local schools and community-based organizations to get young people involved in planning what our community should look like. And we had over 100 people participate in the redevelopment planning process. And not surprisingly, they wanted similar things that the older adults wanted, but they didn't want it all in one place. Parents liked it all in one place and one stop. Young people wanted it spread out across the community, and we worked to accomplish that. The Boys and Girls Club were looking at another community center over in the Pleasure Point area as well. The other thing is that when we're planning facilities, we need to engage young people. So as we look to build Chanticleer Park, we're working with the neighborhood and the young people in the neighborhood to build the bike pump track. When we design the skate park features, we talk to local young people who are going to use that park to find out what it is they wanted. That's an important part. You can't just do it sitting in your office. You have to go out to the community and reach out and bring them into local government.
Mr. McPherson.
Yeah, and I've been walking door to door in every precinct in the 5th District. Sometimes a teenager will come to the door and say, just a minute, let me get my parents. And I said, yeah, before you get to them, I want to talk with you. Because the important part for me in doing this and going door to door is to find out what's on your mind and what matters to you. And in general, that's what we have to do as county supervisors. And just as school districts have a student member on their school boards, many of them, I think we should look at that kind of an outpouring of interest from the youth in our respective districts and have them be engaged in the policy-making process that we have in the county. I think that's very important. And it's very important just to show the students how valuable and important education is as well. And we have two outstanding educational institutions here in Cabrillo College and the UCSC, and we should really tell them the value of that in getting an education.
Given that there will be 5 men on the Board of Supervisors next year, how will you be sure the perspectives of women are well represented at your meetings and in your decision making? I'm going to go ahead and start with Mr. Hammer on this one.
I think it's through outreach. I think partly my staff, I would imagine, I'm going to fill my staff with a couple of women, because some of the smartest people around me that are helping me today are women, and I understand that. I also think that we in this county are very lucky. We have a women's commission that is extremely strong, and they're a huge advocate for equal rights for everybody, and especially women. And they've tasked the Board of Supervisors to collect data, to go out to all the departments within the county and make sure that everybody is getting equal treatment, equal pay, and equal access to services. And I would continue along that process, and I would reach out to that commission, to people like Sheila Delaney, to make sure that particular section of our community is represented. Thank you.
All right, who do I want to pick on now? We'll go with Mr. Friend.
Well, for the first time in really recent history, this is going to be the situation on the Board of Supervisors, and I think it is something to be mindful of, quite frankly. I think that it's something my wife actually reminds me of all the time. And I just simply think that I agree with Mr. Hammer on the outreach component, but I also think that really what it is you bring a set of values to the board. I mean, it doesn't matter the gender of the person that's elected. Quite frankly, it has to do with a set of values, and there shouldn't be any particular litmus test when you vote for somebody. But I think that it's essential that the people that are here are held accountable for all kinds of interests to represent their district, and I think that this is a very important one of them. But I think that whoever's, you know, those of us that are fortunate enough to be elected, that we recognize that this is the first time in recent history that such a thing's occurred at the board, and it's something that we should be mindful and respectful of.
Thank you. Mr. McPherson?
I think it's interesting. We just have to be mindful of that, and it begins at home with me, with my wife of 44 years, Mary. And to recognize the interests of women throughout. I think it's significant. We did have a woman who was a candidate for this seat in the 5th District. She has dropped out of the race. Her name will be on the ballot, but Susan Weber has endorsed me to be the county supervisor of the 5th District. I think that says something for itself. But I do think that we also have to be mindful that really women probably make up the majority of our population. And we need to really have the sensitivity of what are their concerns of them. It is true that we don't have a woman on the board for quite some time, or will not have after this election. I think that's unfortunate, but I do think the past record that I've had has shown me very sensitive to women's issues, and I will continue to do so as county supervisor.
Mr. McInnes.
I'm just hoping that we see the kind of participation by women at the county supervisor meetings that we see here today. I'm looking at an audience that's predominantly female, and hopefully that's will go forward as I if I get elected to the supervisor. I'll reach out to the female community and make sure that your voice is heard and is reflected in how I run the second district. I have my campaign manager, who's a female, Tammy Davis, and I would definitely look at adding her as one of my assistants. So I think it's important that you're heard. Even though there won't be a female on the county supervisors, you will definitely have a voice within the county if I'm elected. Thank you.
Mr. Leopold.
Thank you. I want to point out that although the board will be changing its the gender makeup, the leadership in the county is strong with women. Our county administrative officer, our health services agency director, our human services director, and our planning director, to just name a few, are women. And it's important to work with all of our departments, and it's also important to, as a man, to make sure that we are representing the needs of the entire community. Recently, I brought some items to the board about expanding reproductive health options for women. And last month, I also brought something to the board around, at the suggestion of our Women's Commission, to look at the decisions made by the county and make sure there aren't gender biases in those decision-making process. It came out of the Women's Commission's status on women and girls in Santa Cruz County, and it really showed that in a community like ours, where we pride ourselves on being diverse and being representative of everyone here, there were still significant hurdles. As a county supervisor, we need to keep that in mind and work on that every day.
Thank you. Mr. Rivas.
Yes, for me, you know, married for 42 years, a wonderful woman and a registered nurse, is something that is important to me, that women participate in any part of decisions. One of the things that, you know, has the city council member, City of Watsonville, that's one of the things that I did to appoint a lot of my commissions to appoint women in that area. And my intent was is to, so they themselves be able to understand and be involved and also run for elected appointment. So if, as a county supervisor, I will do the same. Try to encourage and at the same time appoint women so they can be able to take, you know, this position as a county supervisor, because we need to train them so they can be, get involved as a county supervisor or any elected, you know, a position that is important that the women can participate more. And I think, you know, like Leopold said, we have so, you know, beautiful, powerful women in the county government that they're leading the agencies anyway, so we have to work with them, and they make a lot of decisions. They make the recommendation to the county supervisor, so that's something that we always take that information, and mostly we have very, very professional as well women that within our county, and continue to do so, and
thank
we continue
you,
have
Rivas.
To do that.
Gonna go ahead and turn this over to Mr. Arnold, please.
Yeah, generally, I think the board has been gender blind, which is fine. Women have the same yearnings for self-government and liberty as men do, and they have the same virtues and flaws as we do. The thing, if you'll note, that the board usually votes 5-0, and they vote as a machine, and that should be your concern.
All right. Okay, we're going to move on to the next question. I do want to remind the candidates to please pay attention to the time that's going on here and make sure that we give everybody equal time to speak. We try to keep this to a minute. I will not cut you off out of respect, but I would ask that you give your counterparts equal opportunity. Many parts of Santa Cruz County has been designated as a food desert. What would you do to help change this? And I'm just going to go ahead and, for the sake of everyone, a food desert is when there's not exactly healthy, nutritious food around a central location or around a neighborhood, or it's highly inundated with not so healthy food. I don't want to go into brands, but just food that isn't necessarily what you would want people to eat if they're needing healthy, nutritious food. I'm going to go ahead and start with Mr. Arnold on this one.
Yes, I think that's changing. It's going to change radically, not only for California, but the rest of the United States. And I was involved with the labeling with the GMOs in the state of California. I think merely that alone, and this I think is a corrective ability for most of our problems, is transparency and identification. And I think that will have a very corrective thing going all the way to your 7-Elevens.
Mr. McPherson.
I think that we have a very sensitive community in a lot of areas, and I think our food and nutrition, as I said, that the concern of obesity in our community, in our state, in our nation is huge. And it's the long-term healthcare needs that we're going to have to provide those that get, that diabetes comes upon them, is going to be very, very costly. but more serious than that, a very personal and sensitive issue, health issue for them. We have, as I want to repeat again, we have an agricultural community here that is very sensitive. And having been the campaign food drive chairman for Second Harvest Food Bank a couple of years and still being the advisory board chair of Second Harvest Food Bank, I know for a fact that the agricultural community will cooperate with us in the best way possible to provide healthy and nutritional foods for our youth and for our community as a whole.
Thank you, Mr. McPherson. Mr. Rivas, please.
Yeah, I think, you know, we have to continue to limit our fast food, you know, restaurants around our county. But at the same time, I think, you know, the Harvest Food Bank has been able to, and working with the ag community, be able to provide more nutritional foods to our community has been what I see and what we have per policies and ordinance within different areas. I think it's important that we continue to provide those kind of areas and provide more information so our community can be more healthy. And I think that's something that we have to go forward as a county of Santa Cruz.
Mr. Hammer?
I think it starts with education at home about how to feed your kids and what's appropriate. We need to take a look at changing what our kids look up to in their advertising. We see Burger King, McDonald's ads, In-N-Out Burger, which, you know, is good but really bad for you.
We call that sometimes food. Sorry.
Sometimes food. Anyways, we need to change the imaging around that because kids look up to that, and that's where they want to go. And it's also ease of access. We need to change that image. In the San Lorenzo Valley, we also are trying to help those people that need more nutritious foods. If you take a look at the outreach and the pantries that are done at Valley Churches United and Mountain Community Resource Center, a lot of the food does come from Second Harvest, which is fantastic. But these are people that need nutritious foods, and they're being provided by some of the nonprofits. But I think that we need to see on every corner little farmers markets. We have enough organic growing and enough organic farmers that we need to provide those. That's what you need to see on the street corners. You don't need to see In-N-Outs and Taco Bell, but they do bring in taxes as part of the problem.
Mr. McGinnis.
Yeah, unfortunately, I grew up on fast food at school. Like I said, we had Taco Tuesday. But I think as we change the food that's offered to our kids in school, starting in elementary school through middle school and high school, they'll start to look for those better options out in the community, and then those businesses will start to offer those choices because businesses are in business to make money and they want to sell their products, but they'll sell what the community is looking for. So it really starts at a young age and then it goes from there. Thank you.
Mr. Leopold.
What we're really talking about here is land use planning and really thinking about what it is we want to see in our community. We are just about to undertake a new study on the Soquel Drive corridor, basically from the overpass near Dominican all the way to Freedom Boulevard. This is a chance for us to envision what it is we like to see and make sure that there is good, healthy food access all along that corridor so people who live there can walk and access that food. We also have to avoid traveling on the low road of economic development. And I don't think the county should change its rules to allow drive-through restaurants. But I can't tell you how many county bureaucrats, private landowners, and others have come to me and say, we should be competing for an In-N-Out Burger. You see other local cities putting up Facebook pages in order to get one. But if we really care about what we're going to be eating and what we want our children to eat, we shouldn't make it easier for these outlets to open. We should really do some planning and describe what it is we want to see and make that happen.
Mr. Friend.
I agree with Mr. Leopold about this being fundamentally a land use issue, especially with a lot of the new development that's going to be going in. But secondly, this really is a shame. I mean, think about where we live. One of the reasons why I live here, and there's more agricultural land in the second district than any other district in the county, is for access to this food. This is exactly supporting the CSA, supporting the farmers markets. If you can build those relationships, similar to the school question, if you can leverage the relationships and make it local, and make it fresh, and make it accessible, and therefore fundamentally bring down the cost and benefit everybody that's involved, I think that you're going to see a significant change. I mean, it's totally changed the way that I eat, growing up in Southern California versus growing up versus living here for the last 14 years. And I think that exactly that, both on land use and moving forward on the partnerships, I think you can have a significant impact on that. Thanks.
Thank you. And I've had the opportunity, if you haven't, to fly over the county in a helicopter. You can actually see it's the seventh largest ag business in the world, right here in this county. So I really resonate with what you guys are saying. Unfortunately, this might be a question that's a little uncomfortable for Zach. I'm not sure if it's a compliment or a detriment. I was asked, are Zach and I twins? So I'll go ahead and take that. Mr. Friend, would you please?
By the looks of the tattoos I can see on you, no. all my clothes will stay on, but I have no tattoos.
I got them covered up. Anyway, sorry. I'd like to have a little bit of fun with the candidates and the panelists. Okay.
I am an identical twin, and I resent the twin exploitation that's going on here.
But not to us.
Just in case you didn't know, Zach and I will be running together for... No, I'm just kidding. All right, so as I get to this last question, I just wanted to remind everybody what we're here for. We're at the Supervisorial Candidate Forum on Child Health and Nutrition at the new Resource Center for Nonviolence. It's it's sponsored by Gopher Health and United Way of Santa Cruz County, co-sponsored by WIC, First Five, Gopher Health, Child Care Planning Council, Second Harvest Food Bank, and the Central Coast School Food Alliance. So as I asked this last question, and I think it's something that people obviously have a big concern about, so it's actually almost a duplicative question, if that's a word. Food service directors at schools say they do not have the resources to make a significant impact on improving the nutrition of school meals. What's the county's role in better school meals, and how would you help get the resources into the hands of the food service directors? I'm going to go ahead and start with Mr. McGinnis on this.
I watched a show on TV about a week or so ago where they moved away from prepackaged, pre-prepared foods, probably the same stuff I was being served when I was in school. And it was a nonprofit based out of, I believe, San Francisco, and they had moved to all fresh foods, and it was all prepared freshly, and there was actually a savings in the overall budget and money spent by the school to provide the fresher lunches. And they even interviewed the kids, and they had a little food plate with fruit and salad and a main meal, and the kids thought it was the best food ever. I'm sure their parents aren't too happy about that, but so I could see there is a way to do it. It's just a matter of putting the programs in place and working with the proper people, and it could be a nonprofit. It might be something that the county does, or it's just a matter of working with the infrastructure in place and educating them and putting it in place. Thank you.
Mr. Arnold.
Yeah, I really think this has to do with the school boards themselves. We need to get rid of the Department of Education, which sucks up millions and billions of dollars with thousands of employees in Washington, D.C. What they do is they take your taxes from here, they send them back to Washington, D.C., they keep about 80%, they put strings on them, they send them back to the schools. I think the school boards need to regain their sovereignty in their community so that they can dictate what's best for their children, who they know, in their culture, in their community. This homogenization by the national government is bad for business in the world. We're like 26 or something like that in science, and you go through each of the other comparisons. We're not doing well. And it needs to go back to the parents and the people that you vote in those school boards to make these decisions. And how far, if your school board wants to give them meals and cots and everything else, that's up to them. Let them take care of that and let them pay for it. But everybody shouldn't be participating in this. We shouldn't be communized where every person is made into one particular result, a human resource for the cartels.
Mr. Rivas.
I just continued that, you know, the youth is to empower the youth. You know, Jóvenes Sanos has been a great advocate in regards to making presentation to the school board members, at the same time be able to work with the food services, working with the community, with the business, with the restaurants. It's something that they need to be continued to be done. I think, you know, and with that matter, I think, you know, Jóvenes Sanos has been one of those youth empowerment that I'm very proud of it. And I think we have to do it throughout the school district. And now Pajaro Valley Unified School District be able to receive a lot of the a lot of nutritional meals within the food services and the lunches, the breakfast. And that's important that we continue to do so within our county. And I think something that the council that we continue to do throughout the county. Thank you.
Thank you. Mr. McPherson?
Yeah, I think that this is, if it's school services, we have to be very careful of being one government agency telling others what to do and not leading by example. Government makes that mistake time and time again. Let's be an example ourselves and set a standard over there in the county center of what we should do. And then let's pass that on if we think that's so great, and I think it would be, that we should let school services know. This is what we're doing. We think we should lead by example. I think we don't tell other people to do what we're not doing. I think we have to be an example of how to best provide nutritional foods for other people. And I also think that we could bring in some nutritional experts, health services experts, to go to schools and tell them what the value of a nutritional meal from better education, being sharper in the classroom, right on up or down, however you want to put it. I think those are the types of things that we should do and cooperate with school districts and telling them we can provide this kind of service or this explanation from experts, but we want to work with you to do it. Thank you.
Mr. Leopold?
I served on the Cabrillo College Board for 8 years before I became a county supervisor, and during that time, the food service was a big issue. When we finally got rid of Sodexo Marriott and we got a local vendor, all of a sudden the food got better and sales went up. And the students reported that they liked the food better. As a county supervisor, it's hard to influence the direction of the school lunches or our school food availability outside of working with our public health staff and our human services staff to reach out to folks there. But we can partner with the schools very creatively. And over the past 3 years, we've done partnerships with the Live Oak School District on the Boys and Girls Club, with the Santa Cruz City School District on making safe access to, from Soquel High to Soquel Village, from the Loma Prieta School District to partner with them to install a new gym floor so that they have a good recreational opportunity. And I'm currently working with the Happy Valley School District to help refurbish their field as giving a place where kids can participate in good outdoor activity. By doing this, we also create resources for them to focus on that which is their responsibility, which is school food, by working with them on issues of recreational activities and other support services.
Mr. Hammer?
When I went to Cabrillo College, I got a degree in culinary arts, and one of the programs that we had was, you know, we provided a restaurant. You know, we worked with foods, had a working kitchen. I think that we need to see that also in high school and junior high education, and also primary education, is teaching kids. It used to be called home ec. Now it could be fancy and something a lot more fun on how to work with the fresh foods that we have. At Boulder Creek Elementary, you see it. I helped them build a greenhouse. They're growing fresh vegetables. The kids are going out there at a young age, and they're growing foods and seeing where they're coming from. I think we need to continue that. And I think that if you want to take and look outside the box and how we fund some of this stuff, you know, if we had a 1 cent sales tax on every teaspoon of sugar that was in soda, we could raise $1.3 billion a year. You know, that's going to upset, you know, some big industries, but it's going to make a huge statement. We need to start making some huge statements so that we can make change. Thank you.
Mr. Friend?
Well, the Federal Department of Agriculture has been running pilot programs to do exactly this in a number of urban cities over the last couple of years and have had a lot of success. I think the question really is one of empowerment. I mean, the question speaks to someone feeling like they just don't have the authority or the ability. I completely agree that school districts are autonomous and they should be that way. When you're an elected official, though, you are an advocate. You represent your people. In your district, and if people feel like their voice isn't being heard or that they're not being empowered, then it's important for you to help be that bridge between them and the people that should and can be making the decisions, in this case the school boards and the County Office of Education. So I think that is the key part for the elected official, and I also think knowing that there have been pilot programs just in the last 2 years that are going on currently where this exact model has worked, it's reduced costs, and students are enjoying the healthy foods even more.
All right, I want to take a moment to just mention that Community TV will be broadcasting this at a later date, and for you to go ahead and check communitytv.org. I would like to, first of all, thank the panelists for being involved here today. Thank you guys for allowing me to moderate this. Thanks to all the sponsors that have been involved, Gopher Health, United Way of Santa Cruz County, WIC, First Five, Gopher Health, Child Care Planning Council, Second Harvest Food Bank, and Central Coast School Food Alliance. I'm now going to turn you guys an opportunity to speak for 2 minutes to close this out, and I'm going to go ahead and start with Mr. Hammer.
Caught me by surprise there for a second. I want to thank everybody for being here today and giving us an opportunity to talk about health of children. Our kids are our future, and if we don't give them the educational resources that are necessary, they're not going to strive to the levels that they should. And it starts at an early age. Early education is extremely important, and it needs to come from every sector of the community. It needs to start at home with strong parenting, and to get strong parenting, we need to, parents have to look for help also sometimes. We place our kids in the care of organizations or child care facilities when we go off to work. The majority of our public does. They need to be well-funded, well-educated organizations and groups. And we're lucky in this county. We have a fantastic support system. It's not large enough. It's not funded well enough. But we have professionals that understand how important our 3-year-olds, 4-year-olds, and 5-year-olds are. There's a test out there that they say in third grade you can take, and they can tell you how many beds you're going to need in prisons based on the test scores of our kids. I think that's a problem. You know, I think that watching my 6.5-year-old twins grow, what they learn on a daily basis is amazing. Their ability to grasp what's going on in a day-to-day life and the pain that they can feel about what's going on around them, and the pains that they're feeling is coming from school, coming from their aftercare programs. We need to make sure that we support early education, childhood development, and I look to the people that are here in this room to continue providing such excellent service. Thank you.
Mr. Rivas.
Yes, I just want to thank everybody to be here today and talking about the issue about the health problems that we face in our community. One of the things, you know, when I became mayor and being in the city council for 8 years, it's something that I participated in a 1-year training with the NALEO program. And the purpose was is to implement policies and action plans within our communities. And that's one of the things that I did to be proactive within the city of Watsonville. And that's why we adopted a lot of the ordinance and working with the schools and working with the nonprofits and working, and also we developed the whole Ensanas, working with the whole Ensanas of Parks and Recreation, so we can be able to continue to provide healthy communities. And healthy and safe communities, that's what we call them in the city of Watsonville. And it's important we continue to do so on the county level. And I think, you know, whoever, you know, elects the county service, I think we need to do that. I think, you know, we live in a beautiful area, and we sometimes think that we eat healthy, but according to statistics, we not. I think we need to do, obesity is a big problem. We have a heart disease problems in our community. And, you know, so something that we need to do. And we need to do action plans at the county level, how we're gonna be doing this county level. And we don't want it to be the last, here we say in the 45, 54 in the district that we, you know, but it's a problem, we need to attack it. And that's the way we have to do it. Thank you.
Mr. Leopold.
Well, I want to thank the sponsors for putting together this forum. These issues are really critical, and I appreciate the leadership of so many in the room who work on such critical issues. My background has prepared me well for this job as county supervisor. I've worked in education at the Cabrillo College Board of Trustees, led the Soquel School Bond campaign back in 2001, on healthcare as the executive director of the Santa Cruz AIDS Project, and as a part of the team that created the Children's Health Initiative, which provides a health insurance for 10,000 kids here in Santa Cruz County. As a member of the Board of Supervisors, I've worked very hard to lead on many of the issues that we've talked here today. County government has to work to find a way to say yes to things, to think creatively. Santa Cruz is a great laboratory. We should take advantage of that, create creative programs, and work to address the challenges that we face. We don't it's not just a question of money, it's a question of letting loose the creativity of program directors and the community in order to solve our common problems. I think we can do that. I have a history of working together with others, and that's why I have the support of so many members of school boards, the Board of Supervisors, city councils, fire boards, the County Office of Education, neighborhood association leaders, and business leaders, because they've worked with me in the last 3.5 years, or sometime before that, and they know that I'm someone that you can work with and you can effectively get something done. We need in Santa Cruz to be able to lead not only in our county but in the state of California. We have a history of doing that, and I'm confident that we can continue to do that into the future. Thanks again for holding this forum. Thank you for your leadership, Danny in particular. You are an incredible leader from the First District, and we're well represented by you.
Thank you, John. Mr. Friend.
Well, thank you for not just having this forum, but allowing us to be up here. One thing that I can't say enough of, and I feel like I do say it every time, is how much of a privilege it's been to even be up here and to be able to run. As I've spent the last 6 months meeting with people in my district, I've learned that there are a lot of voices that aren't being heard, and there are a lot of people that wouldn't even have the privilege to be sitting where we're sitting to even give this an opportunity. And those are the people that we need to represent. Those are the people whose voices that we need to bring to the Board of Supervisors. Some of their stories are heart-wrenching. Some of them are really remarkable when you think about the area that we live. We live in one of the most beautiful places in the world, but we've seen what threats to funding and cuts to funding have done, from everything from our local roads to social health and human services, public safety, and now the even proposals to pave over prime farm ag land in our area. These are things that I think, quite frankly, we actually can overcome. I think that similar to the national, totally failed national debate, and this shows you why local elections really do matter, because this is where we live and this is where impacts can be made. I think that we just, in many ways, need to get the politics out of policy, local public policy, and be willing to take chances on things. One of the things that cuts does present is the ability for you to take risks. And as Supervisor Leopold said, empower the staff and empower nonprofits to actually do what you do best, not get in your way in these kinds of situations. Take those risks, remember who it is that we serve, and remember that there's a lot of people that aren't in this room that couldn't even make it here because they're working two jobs or whatever it may be, that we need to remember who those people are, and their voice is just as equal, if not more important, than many of ours in this political process. So thank you for having me.
Mr. Arnold.
Yes. I think there's been a big cover-up by the political machine. I encourage you to go to Gary Arnold, Man Against the Machine, because there you'll have a lot of reasons to vote for or against me there. I think one of the big cover-ups is Operation Cloverleaf, and that you can appreciate, you can thank your lying Sentinel newspaper. The Sentinel is owned by, the stock is owned by Bill Gates and Bank of America. They also own the Mercury and the Monterey Herald. So you're kind of sitting in here in a shell here, not getting the full information. Operation Cloverleaf is run out of McLean, Virginia. It's distributes aluminum and barium over the Monterey Bay area. It's run by James Schlesinger, former head of the CIA. And when the USA Today did a front page story on it, it said it's the worst case scenario as far as health is concerned. We have two people on a board of supervisors that sit on the Air Resources Board. They have the full right, and they should have had the authority, to make sure that our air is clear. It's injuring people, plants, and animals, and the fish. The other thing that you've been lied about is the Gestapo meters, the so-called smart meters put out by PG&E. That's a contract with ICLEI, also the World Bank, in which your city of Santa Cruz and your county of Santa Cruz has contracts with. You look at ICLEI's IRS report, and you find that it says their purpose is to impose Agenda 21. That was signed by Sam Farr, whom Zach Friend worked for. Your Board of Supervisors rubber stamps Agenda 21 protocols time after time. So if you want somebody out there that will tell you something that the newspapers won't tell you, they won't tell you, vote for me. I'm the man against the machine. Look at the website. And like I said, there's a lot of content on there for you.
Mr. McInnes.
I want to thank you for the opportunity to speak today. A little bit about me. I own a small business. It's the Seabreeze Tavern. It's located in the heart of the 2nd District down on Rio Del Mar Beach. And I definitely love Santa Cruz. I've been here for about 15 years, and this is where I wanted to live and retire. And I want to be a champion for small business in the county and make it easier for small businesses to thrive in our area. I've had a tough time with my small business through the economic downturn, and I've had a few problems with our county planning department, but that's another story. I plan on being a resident in this county for a long time coming, and if I'm elected, I will work hard and to the best of my abilities to provide the residents and of the 2nd District a voice in our county. And please feel free to drop by the Seabreeze Tavern any Friday, Saturday, or Sunday after 6 p.m., and you can talk with me in person. Thank you.
Mr. McPherson.
Thank you. I pledge to you to continue doing what I've done all my life, and that is give back to this community if I should be fortunate enough to be elected county supervisor. My father said we were very fortunate to be born here, and let's leave this place a better place than when we found it. And I've done what I can throughout my life to do that, whether it be the chair of the Second Harvest Food Bank Drive, or my wife Mary and I back in the 80s. Establishing a dropout prevention program in schools, because you can tell when children are young some of the so-called troublemakers who need to be reined in, shall we say, to have a teacher, a counselor, and a parent get together to talk about what's the problem here, let's solve it. It's one-on-one, it's been very workable, and it's been very successful. When I was in the legislature, I gave every pay raise that I've received back to the community in education programs and healthcare programs. It was recognized by the California Wellness Foundation as Legislator of the Year, along with John Burton and John Vasconcellos. I was the author of a kin gap measure for foster care children to allow grandparents or relatives to really oversee or take the foster children in instead of having some stranger do it and be reimbursed for it. That is a model in this state, or it was this model in this state is a model for the nation today. And also I was a key vote in the Healthy Families program that provided child care for those 6 and younger and made it a real point to do so. These are things that I have done in the past and will continue to do so in the future. We have, as I say, some serious health problems, especially with the diabetes issue. We need to be cooperative and get our act together. I'll continue to work for these programs, and I respectfully ask for your vote for Bruce McPherson on June 5th. Thank you very much.
Well, I would like to thank the panelists once again. I'd like to make sure, I would ask, if I was to ask a question, that each and one of you would please go visit some of our wonderful nonprofits within this county. I obviously know you guys are very busy. Some of you have come through. It's just a great way to get a hands-on opportunity and actually speak to the people that are doing all the work within the county. You guys support them through different fundings, and it's just really important that you guys have a better comprehension as to what each and every one of these people do every day to service the community and the constituents that get you guys elected. We're going to go ahead and wrap this up. I just wanted you guys to know we were here for the Supervisorial Candidate Forum on Child Health and Nutrition, hosted by Gopher Health and the United Way of Santa Cruz County. This will be broadcast on Community TV at a later date. Please check communitytv.org for more information. Our co-sponsors of the event are WIC, First Five, Gopher Health, Child Planning Council, Second Harvest Food Bank, and the Central Coast School Food Alliance. Just a little input on what Gopher Health is. It's a countywide collaborative to increase access to healthy eating and active living for our youth. Thanks to each of the candidates for participating, and we invite everyone here today to get involved and take action towards positive change in our community. So my name is Danny Keith. Thanks, guys. I really appreciate your time. Thank you. Can we get a round of applause for these guys?